your son. And
yeah, that really touched me.
Cause I wanted to retaliate, and I noticed that we didn't have no real strong leaders that would even say what I just said.
Yes, sir.
And so I declared, "I'm your son." And I still feel like that today.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So my mother's discipline caused me to run away from home. And based on the effect discipline had on me, I believe that's why some brothers and sisters don't join the Nation of Islam, because of the discipline.
The discipline, the structure, yeah.
So I wound up going into selling drugs, selling syrup, selling reefer, using heroin myself. Ran into somebody that knew how to mix liquid cocaine and heroin together. And I was the type of drug dealer that when I look at myself in the mirror, knowing how I was raised,
yes, sir,
I get dissatisfied with myself.
That conscience is kicking in.
Right, and then I would just quit.
Yes, sir.
I would quit using drugs. So this particular time, I was invited by this brother. Well, I call him a brother now, but I was invited by this hustler to his house. And so he laid out the liquid cocaine, and I laid out the heroin. But by me quit shooting drugs, I got caught like slipping. Like my son made a record, Don't Lack, right? Yeah. So I got caught lacking.
Got caught lacking.
Right, yes. I went in the kitchen making sandwiches and left dope fiends with the drugs. When I come back, they done cooked up the drugs I put on the table and everything.
Yeah.
And so my position was, okay, so y'all know I quit shooting drugs. I said, so basically, if I don't shoot these drugs, y'all just done took my stuff from me, right? So I said, all right then, I'm gonna go ahead and shoot it up. Now the thing is, I never had liquid cocaine before. I had heroin.
Yes, sir.
Man, when I shot that liquid cocaine mixed with heroin up, boom, took off like a jet, man.
Yes, sir.
And then that adrenaline made me reach for the pistol and put it in his mouth. I said, didn't I tell you I ain't want to shoot this stuff, you know?
Yeah.
So the women started hollering, don't kill him, don't kill him, baby, don't kill him. So I said, man, I'm going to blow your... And then the heroin kicked in.
It slowed you down.
It slowed me down, man. You know what I mean? And that's how I wind up not pulling the trigger.
That's a heck of a thing. Because I was wondering, when you were explaining that about the cocaine, because like I said, you pretty much said cocaine is, it put you on 10, as the young people say, and the heroin would bring it down.
Bring it down.
So it's like, that's a heck of a, that's a dangerous combination.
Well, especially if you doing it for the first time.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? Just to save your, I guess pride ain't the right word, but like I said, if I didn't shoot it, they just took my drugs from me.
Yeah, so
you know
had
what
to
I
save
mean?
Faith.
I had to save faith,
sir.
Right?
I get you. Yes, sir.
So eventually I wind up on the corner we used to stand up under the L on 47th I forgot what streets, either Calumet and whatever the next street is.
Oh, I
know
you're talking about. Okay. That's
and it was a shoe shine shop up under there.
Yes, sir.
Where we all went to get our shoes. So one day I was standing with a brother named Bull. Mm-hmm. And he was one of the founding members, from what I was told, of the Blackstone Rangers.
Okay.
And believe it or not, we used to stand up under there talking about politics,
yes,
and Jesse Jackson.
Yes, sir.
So we were standing out there.
So around what year is that?
I can't remember. I'll say I came home from prison in 1980, so it had to be like between 75.
I get you.
I'll just stop right there.
I get you.
So we standing under the L talking.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, a dull gray haze came over me in the street.
Mm-hmm.
And the voice came up in me and says, somebody's trying to kill you.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody's trying to kill you.
And this is right after you had left the house, after you had put the gun in the guy's mouth.
No, that was a different incident.
Oh, okay.
No, this is another incident.
Okay.
And I was just on what we used to call the stroll.
Gotcha.
Socializing with Bull and talking politics,
yes,
and
sir,
stuff, right? So then the street just turned like a gray haze,
mm-hmm,
and the voice came up and said, somebody trying to kill you.
Mm-hmm.
So I backed upside the wall, and I'm looking everybody in the eye.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like real paranoia came up in me. I'm looking everybody in the eye, and my car is parked around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I walked straight past my car, all the way down 47th Street. I lived on the corner of 47 and Drexel.
Okay.
I think that it was the Sutherland Hotel.
Yeah, he was going east.
Yeah, I was going east.
Mm-hmm.
And as I'm coming, okay, say this building right here, next to it is a vacant lot.
Yes, sir.
As I'm coming up to the vacant lot, a brother ran out from around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And when I saw him, I started like beating him down.
Because
he had ran off with my pills I had gave him to sell.
Oh, okay.
So I started like beating him down, and then somebody that I know don't like me ran from the other side of the street to help me beat him down. So I left him beating him. I said in my mind, what do you think I owe him?
Because
I know he don't like me, right?
Yes,
so
sir.
I left him beating him. I went to the other side.
Mm-hmm.
As I got near the corner, it was a place where the dope fiends get their methadone.
Mm-hmm.
Right there on, I think that was St. Lawrence.
Okay.
But anyway, they go in and they drop their urine,
yes,
right?
Sir.
So one of the dope fiends seen me coming, and he propositioned me, man, let me give you $10 for your urine, right? And I say, what, nigga, man? You know, push past him, right?
Mm-hmm.
He trying to buy my urine so that he could have a clean drop
yeah,
to get the methadone,
yes,
right?
Sir.
So I push past him. I see my sisters right to my right. And I see a brother in such a deep nod.
Mm-hmm.
And he leaned over and he doing this to his face,
mm-hmm,
and all of that. And then the women, hands were swollen up like basketball.
Right.
I mean, like boxing gloves.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
From shooting it, you know. And as I walked past them, I looked back. And took a few steps forward. And I analyzed in my mind, I say, where you at right now in the game, you could go all the way to the top.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I got a word. I got respect. I could go to the top. Then I look back at my people. when I look back at my brothers and my sisters, I said, to hell with the game.
Yes, sir.
I'd rather die alcoholic or a dope fiend on the curb with my people. I quit.
Yes, sir.
And I meant it.
Yes, sir.
Until I got home and realized I still had some drugs left. I went back to get rid of the pills. They was using T's and Blues at that time.
Okay.
And I wind up getting busted. It was so many. I was the only one that had some at that time. It was dry. And it was so many dope fiends in the alley surrounding me.
Yeah.
They're getting the T's and Blues, and I'm collecting money. And
so you put yourself out there. You made yourself a target for the authorities.
Call myself getting rid of the last little bit so I could quit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yes, sir.
So I wind up. I'm standing there, dope fiends around me, pill heads or whatever. And nobody said a single word. They just moved to the side, and when the front row moved to the side, it was the nose of the police car. And I'm standing there with all these pills in my hand. Not one single pill head said po-po or nothing.
God, it was focused.
Right, so I wind up getting locked up.
How many years?
Well, this was just the county jail, but 5 years all total, if you're talking about.
Yes, sir.
Penitentiary.
Yes, sir.
But I didn't add the time that you'd be in the county jail going back and forth to court.
Yeah, prior to actually going to the penitentiary.
Right, prior to going to the penitentiary. So the bottom line, I was so angry when I got to the Cook County Jail. I had determined I'm not doing nothing but what I want to do.
Okay.
Ain't no gang leaders. I don't care who you are or who you represent. I ain't doing nothing but what I want to do.
Yes, sir.
So when they took me up to the tier, like that light is right there, it was a TV screen there. And I'm at the bars, and the inmates on the inside is sitting at tables where, you know, they eat at.
Yes, sir.
But they was watching TV.
Yes, sir.
And so I'm scanning, just like when they said somebody, the voice said somebody trying to kill you, I'm scanning, looking in everybody's eyes. When I grab the bars, I start scanning, trying to determine who the leader is. Because I'm dead serious about this. We're not going to wait, test each other, try each other out or nothing. We're going to get it right on.
Nip this in the bud.
Right, nip this in the bud. So when I grab the bars, I'm scanning the room, and over here to my left, it's this brother, you know, built, lift weights, you know what I mean? And brother sitting on each side of him at this table over here. So when I looked in his eyes, I got ready to turn away, and then I realized, man, I ain't seen no look in no man's eyes like that before. So I said, oh, so you must be the leader. I'll be sitting next to you soon as they knock these gates down, right?
Yes, sir.
So I went over there and sat next to him. He acted like he didn't even see me. And he started describing the book of Revelations and telling us, according to the book of Revelations, the next president is supposed to be a Christian and more specifically a Catholic. And he was going deep into things. And I said to myself while I'm sitting there next to him, I said, man, I'm with this dude.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm with him, man. Yeah. I ain't know nobody talk like that. That's the way I talk deep down inside myself,
Find
right?
Somebody you can relate to.
Right. I said, man, I'm with this dude. So now I done forgot about, I don't even know what cell I'm supposed to go to. I don't know nothing. I done got lost in his teaching, right?
Yeah.
And so you heard this steel on steel sound, boom, 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 boom. And everybody stood up, so I stood up. So the brother say, what would you do if God walked up to you right now? The one I sat next
yes,
to,
sir.
Right? And he was shorter than me. I looked down at him. I said, I wouldn't do nothing. He said, you wouldn't be scared? I said, no, because if he God, he knew I ain't did nothing but what I had to do to survive. Mm-hmm. And plus, he wouldn't let me know it was him unless he had a good reason.
Okay.
So I take it for granted you could believe God is a man.
Okay.
Now, he's
feeling you out.
Right. In my immature thinking, I'm saying, no, I ain't got no problem with God being a man, and you're going to find out what man it is as soon as you try to get me to do something I don't want to do.
Yes, sir.
This is what I'm thinking,
yes,
right?
Sir. Yes, sir.
So he said, well, the next time you hear that sound, man, that'll be dinner time. And after dinner, we down, all the way down the car, the last cell on your left, we studying Message to the Black Man, where you come. So I went back there, and my first lesson was on elevate, protect, and respect the black woman.
Yes, sir.
And from there, I became a defender of him and the study group.
Yes, sir.
Because the gang leaders on the tier would come and disturb our study group.
Yes, sir.
And Brother Leotis X. Beasley is the brother that asked me the questions about what you would do if God, you know, was
yes,
present
was yeah.
right now. His name was Brother Leotis X. Beasley.
Now, was this the brother they named the fleet of trucks after?
Right, they
okay,
named,
brother,
yeah.
The Leotis fleet.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Well, so I'll go back to what I was getting ready to say. Brother Leotis, that's all he talked about.
Yes, sir.
Was he wanted to be a truck driver and set up a delivery route and deliver the final call. And that's all he talked about when
yes,
he
sir.
Got out, right?
Yes, sir.
So.
And this, bottom line, this is your first introduction to the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That's the
Brother
summation Leotis of this story,
in,
right?
In the Cook County Jail.
Yes, sir.
He introduced me to the way I told you. He introduced me to it. And when he came home, I said 10. Somebody else told me it was only 9. But it was either 9 or 10. But the point is,
yes, sir.
Minister Farrakhan paid cash for all of them trucks.
Okay.
And named them the Leotis fleet.
Yes, sir. I remember.
Because that was Leotis' desire.
Yes, sir. But so, just for clarity and just to speed up just a little bit, so that was your first introduction to the teachings. Now, did Brother Leotis get out before you, or do you?
He got out after me.
After you, so you released first. So you, after you got out, you went ahead and you joined the ranks of the Nation
Absolutely.
Of Islam. Yes, sir.
And then I considered myself a member of the Nation of Islam after I went to my first study group.
Yes, sir. While you was locked up. Yes, sir.
And I defended the Brother Leotis and the group because they had been jumping on him. And the guards, he got in, the inmates outnumbered him and everything, and he was in the 400-pound bench press club. Mm. But he was a kind-hearted
yes, sir.
Brother, and he had been in the military, so he wasn't scared.
Right.
But he just liked to reason with people.
Yes, sir.
And so maybe about the third or fourth time, I got tired of reasoning, right?
Yeah.
So I stepped in front of him. I pushed him to the side. I said, and this leader had the whole corridor look like everybody else on the deck was following him. And we was in a tight corridor, no wider than that.
Yes, sir.
So I pushed Leotis to the side. I said, you know what, Brother Leotis, you like to talk and reason with people too much, man. We ain't doing no talking today.
Yes, sir.
And I looked at their leader. I said, so I can't cuss the way I was cussing, but what do you want to do?
Yes, sir.
And be careful what you say, because soon as the last word cross your lip, we going to get busy.
Yes, sir.
And Allah made this man standing in front of all of his men. Allah caused this man to say, God damn, this nigga looked like he had ripped the roof off of this place. So I ran him away. I said, well, take all them
yes,
faggots you manufacturing with you, right?
Yes, sir.
You looked like you was about to sweat. You didn't know what I was getting ready to say.
I'm a little concerned. we don't want to get sisters too.
Right.
But I feel the love. I feel the passion that's coming from you.
So we ran them away. And the next morning, me and Leotis got up to go up front to eat.
Yes, sir.
They had stole all the food.
Oh, wow.
So then that broke out into a fight. And they leader reached over the door and got a shank. And the brother that used to be in his group, was in study group with us, said he took it. And then that made him run and get the shank and stabbed the brother and then held it at his neck. Mm. So he said, talking to me and Leotis, he said, if you take one more step, I'm going to kill him. I said, well, go ahead and kill him because you leaving right behind him.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? So I don't want to keep going and tell the whole story.
But I got you. And we got the gist of you. We understand. I think that the minister, I don't think I know, and I don't want to misquote it, but what you just said and the way he described you in this, he said concerning the student minister, Abdullah Muhammad, Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan stated he possesses the spirit of Allah and is a born teacher, minister, captain, lieutenant, investigator, and warrior. So that warrior spirit has always been in you.
Right.
So we get it. So but for the sake of time, we're gonna speed it up and talk about your work. But we do have a caller. Let's get this caller on out the way and see what they have to say. Caller, you on the air?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Wa alaikum salam.
I am thoroughly enjoying this show. I greatly appreciate the raw, old school Muslim feel of this interview because the old school Muslims many of them came out of prison, and they pretty much describe the same thing that you have been describing in kind of recent times. I am very familiar with the environment that you talk about, 47th Street, and Ida B. Wells is where I did much of my street dirt. But I tell you, I was down there when Brother Eugene Harris was shot on 38th and Vincennes.
Yes,
and it was
sir.
A horrible thing
yes,
that
sir.
Evening. You know, I come running out to see this man gunned down that way. It was just terrible, you know. And he had been around all that day walking around with two other brothers. And they tell me the other two brothers he was with had done that to him, you know, and it was really tragic. But I so appreciate, you know, you talking the way you do, because people really, really, really need to hear what you got to say, brother. You know, and I'm so happy Mandene got you on the show today. It's a fabulous interview, and it's raw and gritty, and I certainly appreciate it. So thank you, brother, and I do remember you from the early days of the Nation of Islam, when you were Brother Rodney at the time, and you were strong, and you were stern, and you were rigid, and now I know why. So thank you so much, my black brother. You know, may Allah bless you and this great host. Can't wait to see you again.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Wa alaikum salam. Now, yes, he said his whole name, Eugene Harris. Mm-hmm. I called him Bull. That's who I was talking about.
Okay, I understand now. But let's talk about let's speed it up, fast forward a little bit. And so you're in the ranks and you're soldiering. How did it come about that you became that the minister assigned the position of a student minister as far as the prison is concerned?
Well, when I first got out of prison. Mm-hmm. I volunteered to work at his house, and basically everything that's going on in the final call building was going on in the basement of his house.
Correct.
So I volunteered and was blessed by Allah to become the permanent volunteer that Mother Khadijah wanted there every day.
Yes, sir.
So I was working in his home.
Yes, sir.
But I skipped one part. So my first FOI class. Mm-hmm. Was in the basement of Reverend Al Sampson's church.
Yes, sir.
And Reverend Al Sampson gave the key to his church to Minister Farrakhan.
Yes, sir.
And so my first FOI class, I was standing in the back. And when the minister finished, I came up front to shake his hand. Mm-hmm. As soon as he gripped my hand, he said, Allah allowed you to go to prison, brother, to study men, because you got work to do with men.
Yes, sir.
Then I say, 10 years later.
Yes, sir.
I'm driving past the, we call it the palace, or the National House.
National House, yes, sir.
And I'm driving past, and I see all the FOI getting ready to move out. So I say, where y'all going? They say, to the county jail. I say, oh, man, please, ask the Supreme Captain, don't leave me, right?
Yes, sir.
So I was selling fruit bags under the bridge on 47 in Lakeshore Drive at that time. And so I went home to dump the fruit and everything and to change clothes. When I got back, they was gone. I asked them which way they go, so I sped down the expressway. And when I was across the street, I was on the east side of the street. They, the minister then was on the west side, and they was getting out. And so I jumped out and ran over across the street and just fell into the entourage.
Yes, sir.
And so the minister is in there meeting with Mr. Spencer Leak.
Spencer Leak, yeah, yes, sir.
And so I'm on post outside the office. So Brother Abdul Sharif, that's his name nowadays.
Yes, sir.
And he became the Supreme Captain.
Yes, sir.
So he opened up the door, and he said, Brother Abdullah, Minister Farrakhan want to see you.
Yes, sir.
Right, so I'm thinking, oh, man, he needs some water or something. He just wants somebody he feel like he could trust to go get it, right?
Yes,
so I said, I step in with a serving him on my mind,
yes,
right?
Sir. Not realizing they're really getting ready to serve.
Right. Yes, sir. So Spencer Leak is sitting there looking at, behind his desk, looking at me, the minister sitting here in a chair facing Spencer Lee, and then it's another chair to the minister's left.
Yes, sir.
So he said, have a seat, brother. So I came and I sat down. I started to sit down.
Yes, sir.
And before my behind hit the seat, he turned to Spencer Lee and he said, this will be the brother in charge of the Nation of Islam's prison reform ministry because he loves his people and he won't turn back on them.
Yes, sir. Praise be to Allah.
So I ain't going to lie.
Yes, sir. I got you.
I started crying me into.
It's all good. To call. If you got a question, what we going to do, because I need to take a break anyway. So we're going to continue this conversation. This is obviously a part one because we got to come back and really get into, you know, the prison system and everything, my brother. But we're going to go ahead. We're going to take a break. The number to call in, is if you have a question or comment for our dear brother, is 773-434-6625. But we're going to go ahead. We're going to take a break, and we'll come back with more conversation with Student Minister Abdullah Muhammad.
Carmela Muhammad, owner of a foodie spot restaurant located at 7350 South Stony Island Avenue and the new Let's Eat to Live restaurant located at 621 East 67th Street. Both restaurants are located near the Obama Center, the foodie spot in the South Shore area, and Let's Eat to Live in the West Woodlawn area. It was very important to us to have nutritional food for our community. So what you can expect at both of our restaurants, healthy and clean food with a soulful twist, halal meat, non-genetic modified vegetables, and wild-caught fish. As we grow and expand, we're working towards delivering food straight from our farm to table. If we can improve the eating habits and the dining experience of our people in the community, we have done our job. So visit us at the foodie spot at 7350 South Stony Island Avenue and Let's Eat to Live at 621 East 67th Street.
love you. I love you, Emma.
And we are back to the Munir Muhammad Show. And Brother Mandene T. Muhammad still enjoying our conversation with our dear brother, student minister Abdullah Muhammad. And we were just taking a walk through memory lane. But you was talking about before we took the break, when the minister, Brother Minister Farrakhan, had actually assigned to you to over at the Cook County Jails.
Right.
And I think you wanted to build on that and also talk a little bit more about Brother Minister Farrakhan as well before we talk about your work in the prisons.
Well, when I started working in the house, the personal house of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, he was on the road all of the time, so I was like shipping, receiving, and security.
Yes, sir.
For his wife and family.
Mm-hmm.
And they never interviewed me and had me fill out anything or ask me what I was in prison for.
Mm.
None of that.
Yes, sir.
They saw me, my work, and I didn't come for anything. I came asking what y'all need me to do.
Yes, sir.
Not what the nation could do for me.
Yes, sir.
And as a result of me being consistent and my mother being a disciplinarian, I used some buckets they had around to organize the basement and the shipping and the receiving with labels for each state that it was going to. Mother Khadijah came in and said, "Who did this?" And the sisters pointed me out. And Mother Khadijah said, "Them labels got to be tight, brother." And I said, "Well, I can't type," you know. So she didn't say nothing at all. She just left out the room.
Mm-hmm.
I say about an hour and a half later, she came back in the door, set a powder blue typewriter in front of me with white keys, right?
Yes, sir.
And then all she said was, "I said these labels got to be tight." And I've been typing ever since.
Yes, sir. You know? I'm afraid you do too a lot. Yes, sir.
So,
That's a beautiful story.
That's
yes,
the first thing that happened.
Yes, sir. Praise be to Allah. We still got that call. We do have a call of that.
Okay, yes,
question.
Sir.
Caller, you on the air? Caller? Caller going once? Caller going twice? No?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're on. You have a question or comment?
Yes, I would like to ask Brother Abdullah. Yes, I am. This is Brother Zachariah.
Brother Zachariah, before you go any further, cut your volume down on whatever device you're viewing the show on right now because it's a...
Yes, this is Brother Zachariah. Yes.
Okay, cut your volume down, Brother Zachariah. Cut your volume down and then make your comment.
Yes, can you hear me, brother?
I can hear you loud and clear. Go ahead and make your comment.
Yes, we would like to ask Brother Abdullah a question. We here in the Seventh Region extend our generosity to him to come to the Closing the Gap show, and we would like to know a date and time that we can schedule him to come on to the show, sir.
Oh, you putting him on the spot. Okay, well, what we're going to do, we're going to take your name and number down. We're not going to, brother has a, he does have a, itinerary. He has a schedule that he has to keep, so I'm pretty sure he's going to have to check that out. So go ahead and leave your information. Did you want to reply to that?
Well, I see what you're trying to do, but I already told you in my delivery, man, I only do what I want to do.
Yes, sir.
So don't think you can gangster me and front me off in front of all these people. But the answer is yes, but I have to tell you and discuss a date later.
What you telling? Don't let the smooth taste fool them, man. So look, brother. Let's talk about before the time just gets totally away from us. What does your work involve in the prisons? Because I know it's not just the county. you go around to the different. Right. It's not just Illinois either, is it? You go around the country.
Right, national. That means the whole nation of Islam.
Yes, sir. Right. So what does that work entail?
Let me see. Try to be real brief. It entails me putting the knowledge of God and his two messengers into the minds and hearts of the people. Mm-hmm. So that they will be knowledgeable of the time and what they must do. And Minister Farrakhan is representing fulfillment of prophecy. So I know that he's representing the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and in his name he's fulfilling prophecy. And part of the prophecy is having a program to get them out of prison. Mm-hmm. Elijah Muhammad taught Minister Farrakhan to think for the whole. Mm-hmm. For instance, nowadays we want reparations, we want money. Yes. But I haven't heard anybody asking for all of the inmates. Mm-hmm. Except Elijah Muhammad's representative, Minister Farrakhan. Mm-hmm. We got a whole program that includes international relationships and the sharing or trading with each other our intellectual properties.
Yes, sir.
To serve here and abroad. So those that want reparations, they're not talking about give us all of the inmates, because mm-hmm. their mind is built, all of us is guilty.
Yes, sir.
When Minister Farrakhan gives us root knowledge of who the real culprit is, mm-hmm. that he told us about Martin Luther King using the term sanctuary. For the police and the commission of crime among our people.
Yes, sir.
And he's saying sanctuary, that means the police and all of the shooting and killing is protected but limited to our community, mm-hmm. not to spill over into the enemy's community.
Yes, sir.
So part of my job is to represent Minister Farrakhan.
Yes, sir.
to the people and try to make it plain to them mm-hmm. that based on his works to fulfill prophecy, mm-hmm. this close to time for us to come out from under America's oppression and enslavement.
Yes, sir.
So I know I'm representing the Messiah. I don't know who else know or what they believe. I'm speaking for Abdullah.
Yes, sir.
Minister Farrakhan is the fulfiller of Isaiah. Mm-hmm. And how many preachers you know whose mission is to petition the government for all of the inmates? They don't even have a program to be independent and free, justified, and equal mm-hmm. to all mankind. Mm-hmm. So I'm with a man that ain't afraid.
Yes, sir. Understood.
I'm with a man that's a fulfiller of prophecy. And in case anybody don't know it, he's Jesus in our midst. Mm-hmm. He's the only man standing that ain't been bought and ain't gonna bow down. And like, I think it's in Isaiah, where it says that they open not up the up the house of their prisoners. Mm-hmm. It's been a decade or so ago, but one of the presidents passed a law that if anybody go to Libya, they facing 10 years and a $50,000 fine. And Minister Farrakhan said, I'm not aware that I was living on a plantation. Mm. He said, I'm going to Libya to show you what a free man looks like. Mm. And he went. And on his return, the enemies was at the gate in the international section of the airport. Allah did what he already said he could do in the scripture. He blinded them, and the minister walked past them without a disguise, went straight to the rostrum downtown with his power products, set him on the rostrum and started teaching power at last forever.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? So, like the Quran said, there's no doubt in this book. And the book was about Minister Farrakhan, so ain't no reason to doubt him.
Yes, sir. What I want to ask you also, my brother, in our closing moments, like I said, we have to have you come back. So with all that's going on with our young people, and you go and you going in and out to prisons around the country, what message do you have for them to you know, because a lot of times, especially when they're in the county part, that's just for lack of better terms, holding. They haven't been convicted so much. They haven't been sentenced, I should say. So there still may be opportunity for them to get out. But, I mean, is there almost like a scare straight type of message that you may have for those young ones in particular to get them to stop drawing rocks at the prisons or even for them to tell their friends on the outside, this is not it, this is not the route that they should be going? I mean, what message do you have for the young people?
Go straight to it, that the black man is God. Mm-hmm. And they don't know that. Their mind is built on spooks and spirits. And some of them didn't even go to church.
Right.
So I use the truth of who they really are. Mm-hmm. I go to the root.
Yes, sir.
I mix in some lyrics from the popular rap song or something that they can relate to, you know, and but basically it's the truth.
Yes, sir.
And I show them different attributes of God. Mm-hmm. And I make them identify attributes of God and other men.
Yes, sir.
I say, so what attribute do Mike Tyson represent? Mm. They're going to tell me mighty and powerful. Mm. I said, so those are two of the 99 attributes of Allah. So that you mean to tell me that you can see his attributes and don't believe that's him?
Teach.
You know, things like that, right?
Yes, sir.
Have you heard of anybody teaching anything better than that you are God? Mm. And I actually had a brother that used to come to the final call, and he disappeared. And I was in Division 6 at the county jail. He came down. And I said, oh, brother, I've been thinking about you, man. Where you been, man? Uh-huh. I said, why you quit coming around? And he actually told me, I couldn't handle that black man is God.
Wow.
So I say, so you can handle this brown uniform and these numbers they gave you instead of your name. You can handle that.
You gave them to a raw.
Right.
But look, we got two callers and about 4 minutes left. Caller, you on the air. Make it quick. You got a question to come in. You sound like you're on the... Walaikum salam.
Man, brother Abdullah, listen to you, brother. I definitely know about that man voice that the minister said he speaks with, that he's going to be studying men. My question to you, brother, is that could you go over some examples of the suppression of Islam, the teaching of Elijah Muhammad that you have to go through to get the message and the program of Elijah Muhammad to prison?
Yes. All right. We're going to let him answer. I'm going to go ahead and take the other caller, then we'll remember the first we answer him back to back. Go ahead, caller.
I want to say happy anniversary to our brother and illustrious founder, Alif Muhammad, and his beautiful wife, Shakira Muhammad. And once again, thank you for coming on the show, Brother Abdullah.
Go ahead, ask the question, brother.
Okay, answer the question.
The first question, brother. If you can do it in 30 seconds.
Okay, the first question, did he say suppression?
You talk about the ways, if you can quickly, the way they suppress Islam as being, you know, taught in the prisons.
Well, it just take you through a lot of changes. Right now, I had a volunteer ID to a certain institution since last June. And it took me all the way until last Monday to gain access. And then receive permission to come in. And that was because I knew a man that knew a man that knew a man.
Yes, sir.
Otherwise, they wasn't going to let me in.
Yes, sir.
So, yes, sir. So that was, that's basically the only thing I can think of right now.
That's cool. And like I said, when we bring
and they
bring
send guards, they might send guards who falsely accuse you, say that you in there teaching that the white man is the blonde-haired, blue-eyed devil, and Minister Farrakhan don't even allow us to teach that way no more.
Yeah. But let me, as you, in your closing statement, how can the people, because there's a lot of people, a lot of men and women that's in there that seeking information, seeking help, books, things, how can people help you in the work that you're doing in the ministry of in the prisons?
Well, they can write me at 7351 South Stony Island Avenue. Unfortunately, I don't remember the email address.
Well, we're going to get it, and we're going to make sure we put it on.
It's info something. I'll get it back to you.
Yes, sir.
And they could email me or call Lamas at 773-324-6000. Minister Farrakhan gave me an office in Mars, my room.
Yes, sir.
And that's all I can think of.
And we're going to put a pin in it there. But look, my brother, thank you so much. You know, the show went quick, but we got to have you back because you got a lot to say. And look, I know we're winding up, but again, if you have a question or comment for the brother, 324-6000, area code 773, to learn more how you can help out in that ministry. On behalf of the co-founders, of CROE, again, happy anniversary to Brother Ali and Sister Shakira. Also, on behalf of the CROE organization, on behalf of my guest, the Minister Abdullah Muhammad, Brother Minister Munir Farrakhan, the CROE Media Production Team, I'm Brother Mandene T. Muhammad. May Allah continue to bless you with the light of understanding as I greet you in peace.